Before we proceed with the discussion of the tabernacle itself again, let us have a word of prayer. Father, thank you for your many blessings. We thank you for giving to us a wonderful portrait of the plan of salvation through the sanctuary or tabernacle of old. And I pray this morning that as we review these items, that they will come fresh to our minds and that we will be led by the Holy Spirit, and that this will be a blessing to us that we may share with others. In the name of Jesus, amen. So we're going to be examining more detail the actual tabernacle and its various items, which we went through very generally in the past. And we're going to be discussing the various items that are shown here: introduction to the tabernacle, the courtyard, the holy place, and most holy place. I think we will go only to the holy place, and the next time we will do the rest, the most holy place and the high priest. The introduction to the tabernacle. It was God who commanded Moses, Exodus 25:8, let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. God wants to live with his people. When God created Adam and Eve, he placed them in a special garden, and it was his custom to come to them personally and visit with them. And the last time he visited with them, they had sinned. Therefore, they ran and hid. Instead of running out to greet him, they hid, because sin separates us from God. And it brings fear. So God in the wilderness had Moses build a special tabernacle so that he could meet with them. Now, for the holy God to meet with unholy people involves some very serious challenges, and we'll see how God, through the sanctuary, helped them to understand how they, as unholy people, could approach a holy God. The tabernacle was a movable tent of meeting. So wherever they went, their meeting house came with them. And that meeting house was designed in such a way as to help them understand the plan of salvation. So it was that God's plan was initiated in the wilderness with the nation Israel. Now here is a little brief portrait of what was involved in the court. The edges, the black edges, represent the curtain that separated that from all of the rest of the people. Because God is holy, he must protect us from coming into his presence without any preparation, because God is a consuming fire, we're told in both the Old Testament and the New Testament. God is a consuming fire to destroy that which is evil. And so we find that court is surrounded by a curtain. No one could go any further. It was a curtain that was 5 cubits high, which is higher than any man's head. And then we have only one place of interest, and that's the gate. And before that gate is the brazen altar. Now that brazen altar was a symbol of the cross. And the only way we can come to God. Remember, we're moving toward we'll find later on, the last portion, that most holy place is a symbol of God's presence. We're moving toward the presence of a holy God. And in doing so, we must be prepared. The brazen altar brings us to the cross of Christ. Only through Christ and his cross can we have any access to the Father. No man comes into the Father except by me, Jesus said. But more is involved than that. We need the Holy Spirit. The bronze laver is a symbol of the work of the Holy Spirit in purifying the heart. And so next to the bronze altar, we have, between that and the tabernacle, we have the bronze laver, which we will speak more about later on as to the specific function of that. And then we come to the tabernacle. Now, you can't see very well the seven golden candlesticks because they're just little dots there. We'll see it more particular later. But that seven golden candlesticks represent the Christ, the light of the world. Everything about the holy place focuses on Christ. The table that you see below, that's the bread, that is the table showbread that symbolizes Christ. When he was here, he says, "I am the bread of life." And then the little box over in the far side is the altar of incense, which is a symbol of Christ's merits going up before God and bearing our prayers to the Father. And then you'll find in the last section, that's the most holy place. That is the place which symbolizes the very presence of God, concerning which we'll speak more later. You'll notice that all the way around there then is the fence or the outer curtain that surrounds the whole thing and allowing only one point of entrance, which is the gate, which opens to the cross, the symbol of the cross. Now this is a portrait of just the holy place and the most holy place. And you'll see that it says veil or curtain. There was a curtain between the holy place on the left and most holy place on the right, which would be your right and your left. The tabernacle and its courtyard were constructed according to an exact pattern set by God. In fact, if you read Exodus 27:9, also Hebrews, you'll find that in Hebrews 8, it specifically states that Moses was to make that exactly as God showed him. Why? Because every part of the sanctuary and each particular has some significance in pointing to Christ and his gospel. We are to study the tabernacle then to understand God's pattern of worship. Now there are many people today who feel like that we have the freedom to develop our own worship style however we want. The fact is, God has made it very clear that he has a precise plan and everything about his worship is to point to him. And when we begin to develop our own worship styles, we actually are directing attention away from God and to ourselves. And all of these modern methods of worship that are abroad today, these are an abomination to God. They deny his plan to direct the worship plan. The tabernacle shows how common people can have fellowship with the holy God. We mentioned that before. The tabernacle was in the center of the Israelite camp. In other words, we'll see later on in the pictures, the camp was laid out in such a way that three tribes were on the north, three on the east, three on the west, south, and three on the west, so that the whole camp of Israel surrounded the tabernacle, which was the central point of the Israel. The 12 tribes then were encamped in exact order, and God's plan, he intends for us to have order, not just somebody's idea or just as it comes. God has a plan for our lives, and this is true spiritually for our whole life. God plans for us and presents that plan in Scripture. It was Israel's spiritual center for 500 years until Solomon's temple was built, and then the worship shifted to Solomon's temple, which was built on the same basic pattern as the tabernacle. There are 50 chapters in the Bible that discuss the tabernacle, and we will, after we have finished this, we will be studying the book of Hebrews, in which the whole book of Hebrews focuses on Christ and his tabernacle services. And then we will deal with Revelation, which is also a sanctuary book. Because right from the beginning, Revelation is portrayed in the context of the sanctuary. The tabernacle was built using valuable materials such as gold, silver, bronze, and also precious woods and rare cloth and precious stones, as we will see. The gold in the tabernacle totaled over 1 metric ton. In modern terms, that cost would exceed $1 million. I'm sure it would be a great deal more. Now, I don't know just when this was developed, but gold has gone up in price, although in the last few months it's been going down somewhat, but it has gone way up. Offerings from the Israelites paid for all the materials. In fact, they were invited to bring their materials to the sanctuary, and when the sanctuary was built, it was built of all materials that the people had brought from Egypt with them. And when the tabernacle or temple of Solomon was built, the people brought so much materials that they finally had to tell them to stop bringing them because they had all they could use. Now, as we mentioned before, the tabernacle was a type or a shadow of things in heaven and things on earth that related to Christ coming here incarnate and suffering and dying for man. It foretold the redemptive work then of Jesus. In chapter 9, when we get to that of Hebrews, we'll see that the tabernacle services actually portrayed more. It portrayed how Christ's work, when he would leave here, after his resurrection, he would be anointed in a special service in heaven. And we find that in the book of Hebrews as well. The real tabernacle then is in heaven, where Jesus himself is our high priest. The purpose of the earthly tabernacle was simply to point to Christ and his ministry in heaven for us. And we can be grateful for this kindergarten sandbox illustration of the plan of salvation, which is very simple and yet very involved and has a great deal of meaning, which we will discuss some elements of it today. The gate of the court we will discuss, and the court fence, bronze altar, and the bronze laver. Here is the gate of the fence. We already mentioned that you cannot get into the sanctuary without going through that gate. And you cannot get past the gate without coming to the altar of sacrifice, the altar of burnt offering. It's called the altar of continual burnt offering because it was burning day and night and always a sign that Christ is available. His death is a symbol of the fire burning the sacrifices is a symbol of Christ's constant ministry of his sacrifice to us. And here again we see the basic outline of the sanctuary with the altar of sacrifice and then the laver. This is a portrait of that sanctuary with the tents all around it. Three on one side, three on another, and so forth, all the way around. And in that court that is just beyond the court of the temple, it looks like the artist had to draw it with nail in order to get all the camp in. But actually, there's a 1 kilometer of distance between that fence and the nearest tent, all the way around. This was a part of how God showed that unclean people must be cleansed before they can come to a holy God. And so everything about this sanctuary was to portray a holy God and how an unholy people can be cleansed and prepared and come into his presence. The entrance to the court was made with hanging curtains. I mentioned there were 5 cubits, which is about 7.5 feet. And those curtains were hanging all the way around with the gateway, which we will notice too. 4 pillars of brass, it mentions here, for the entrance of the court. And then the fillets or the clasps of silver in which the curtains hung, and they hung on the pillars. There would be 4 pillars, and notice the expensive materials. In this case, it's not as expensive as when you go in. The closer you get to God's throne, the more precious the metals. And so we now turn to the gate to the courtroom. It measures 20 cubits. 20 cubits long, 5 cubits high. You'll find out that the curtain inside the tabernacle that divides the holy place from the most holy place is 10 feet high, and I mean 10 cubits high and 10 cubits wide. This is 5 cubits, but 20 cubits. It's a symbolic of the fact that all of this represents Christ, the same person. Every curtain, every lamb, a bullock, or whatever it was, whether it goat, all of these represented the same person, Christ. The gate separated the people from the magnificent and holy God. God could be approached with repentance and sacrifice. When the people came inside the curtain, the only way they could come inside that curtain was to have a sacrifice with them. Never could a person come into that courtyard without a sacrifice, or they would have been slain by the holiness of God. The very presence of God is a devouring fire to the wicked. And those who come to Christ in faith, taking with them a sacrifice, it is a symbol of the fact that they know that they cannot enter into God's presence except through Christ. No man comes into the Father except by me, and no one can come through the Son except through his sacrifice. When Christ died, he died for the sins of all the world, so that every sin that has been committed was covered by Christ's death. But it's only in faith in Christ's righteousness that we can enter into the presence of God. Jesus referred to himself as the gate. He says, I am the door. No one comes into the Father but by me. And whoever enters through Jesus will receive eternal life. This is what he promises. If we come to Christ, we are guaranteed of life. If we do not come to Christ, there is no way to have life, because in him is life. Those who are in Christ Jesus are assured of eternal life. All others will face not only the first death, which a natural sleep, but the second death from which there is no awakening. And we've already talked about the fence. This is the curtain that goes clear around the tabernacle. The court fence represents two things. First of all, that curtain, each one of those represent Christ. But it also represents sin. Now you say, well, how could it represent sin? You remember when Jesus was here, he was talking to Nicodemus. He said, you have to be born again. And in his discussion with them, he spoke of how we are born again. He talks about Moses lifted up of the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. This is speaking of the cross. That even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believes in him shall have eternal life. So how do we come into God's presence? Through the uplifted Christ, the cross, and through faith in his righteousness. This is the only way we have access to the Father.
Where does the sin come in?
What's that?
You said the sin.
It represents sin because it references Christ who became sin for us. I'm thankful that you mentioned that because I forgot to finish that. In 2 Corinthians 3:18, I believe it is, it says, he who knew no sin became sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God through him. And so when Christ came, he came to meet Satan. He came as a human being to deal with Satan. And Romans 8, verse 3 says what the law could not do, meaning what it could do, the law cannot cleanse. It can condemn, but it can't cleanse. What the law cannot do, and that is weak through the flesh, that's our flesh. God, sending his own Son in the likeness of sin, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh. So Christ became sin for us. When he died, he took with him sin, all sin, to the grave. When he came forth as resurrected Christ, he came forth to give life to everyone who believed in him. For God so loved the world, that whosoever believes on him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. This is the story of John 3 and Jesus' interview with Nicodemus. The court fence was the outer border of the tabernacle site. It consists of the following: the linen curtains, which we've spoken about, and there are pillars, sockets, hooks, and fillets, which have to do with the hanging of the curtains, and something for them to be upon. It also has pins of bronze, which is brass, and these are the various passages of Scripture in Exodus. All of these are from Exodus 27. Christ, God gave absolute details of what the materials were to be, how they were to be prepared, and then later on, God actually, for the construction of Solomon's temple, had a relative, the one at this point God gave them Bezalel, who was specially prepared by God to do all of the fine engraving and so forth that we'll see the need for later on. And then he had an assistant, and those relatives of those very men were the ones that helped build the tabernacle of Solomon. So the measurement of the court, 100 cubits long and 50 cubits wide. That means about 150 feet. A cubit is about a foot and a half. 150 feet by 75 feet wide. And 5 cubits high would be 7.5 feet. Please notice that no one could even see inside when they get up close to it. The only way that a person could be and see inside is come through the curtain and be there before the cross, the symbol of the cross, the altar of continual burnt offering. The bronze altar was the altar of burnt offering that I mentioned, right there in front of the gate. So the first thing a person comes to is the bronze altar. You'll notice that God had them put horns on the corners, all four corners. The horn in Scripture is a symbol of power. And our power comes through the cross. This altar of burnt offering, continual burnt offering, is a symbol of the cross. It's through the cross alone and through Christ and his ministry of his blood that we receive power to overcome. There is no way for anyone to live a righteous life without the power and the presence of Christ through the Holy Spirit. And so there is the bronze altar, and here it is again. We see it with the picture we had before. The bronze altar was made of very precious wood, a shittim wood, very hard wood that would last. And the altar was square and covered with brass, as I mentioned before. It was a bronze or a brass altar. The four corners were overlaid with the bronze, and the entire altar of burnt offering then is designed in such a way as to portray not only the cross, but to portray that which lasts and endures. The bronze, a very heavy, strong metal. And here is this is the symbol of the sacrifice. I mentioned before about the worshiper coming to worship and having to go right to the cross. But also I would like to say that the worshiper wasn't the only one who sacrificed animals. Every morning and every evening, the priests were to offer a perfect lamb so that the lamb would be burning through the day, and then in the evening another one would be placed there and it would be burning until the next morning. So that this is the altar of continual burnt offering. Whatever sacrifices the individuals brought were just added to that which would take place. And that is why they called it, Christ called it the continual. We read about that in Daniel, the continual, or the continual ministry of Christ is what it means. Now, the bronze altar came with utensils, various utensils that were needed for that service. And those utensils were all utensils made of bronze or brass. Bronze shovels, bronze basins, bronze flesh hooks or forks, bronze fire pans that take care of the ashes, and so forth. Everything there is made of bronze. A bronze grate, with a bronze ring on each corner was put under the brazen altar by which they would carry the altar. The hollow staves were made of shittim wood, again, same material, or acacia is what the Bible mentions. And they're covered with bronze. They're wooden, but covered with bronze. And these were placed in the corners of the of the altar burnt offering so they could carry it when they transported the temple from one place to another, the sanctuary. They did not put these on carts like they did the regular furniture and so forth. These were carried by the priests themselves. And those staves that you see in those hooks on the corners were never to be taken out. Everything is a symbol of permanency. Christ is the one who is always, he's continually available. And everything about his work is permanent. I think we will just note here the size of the bronze altar was 5 cubits long, 5 cubits wide, and 3 cubits high. Now remember, a cubit is 1.5 feet, so that'd be 7.5 feet wide, long, 7.5 feet wide, and about 4.5 feet high, which would still be pretty high. So, and then there were steps leading up to it so that they could put the sacrifices on the altar. Several of the offerings were made on the bronze altar, a number of them, including the burnt offering of bulls, sheep, goats, and all without blemish, and also birds. But you see, Christ was to be the Lamb of God without blemish. Christ was perfect in every way, although he became a man subject to temptation as we are. Nevertheless, he was without sin. Also, the grain offerings that were brought and the peace offerings that might be of goats or lambs. The grain offerings were a grain offering that was always offered with the animal offering. And it's very interesting that God intended for his people to become vegetarians. In the wilderness, God gave them what they needed, the water they needed, and so forth, but he gave them manna, a special food from heaven. And that manna was designed to wean people off from the animal products. Every morning they could go out and get the manna they needed for that day. And while they were getting that manna for that day, if they got more than they needed, it didn't help them because it rotted. And by the next morning, it was stinking. So God was teaching people also temperance. And as God was leading them, he gave them instructions for Sabbath special. There would be no manna on Sabbath. Why? Because they were to prepare for the Sabbath ahead of time. On Friday, the sixth day, they would have double manna. There'd be twice as much, and they were to gather that on Friday, the preparation day, to prepare for the Sabbath, and they were to care for that manna in preparation for the Sabbath, so that Sabbath morning when they got up, some people went out to get manna. They thought, well, it's been here all the time, and we'll surely be here tomorrow, but it wasn't. And God was teaching them that on the Sabbath day they were to be all prepared, do all their work during the week. And so the manna would come every day, anything left over would rot until the sixth day. Double portion came the sixth day, and on the seventh day, that double, the second portion, the one was for Sabbath, was still pure and fresh. Instead of rotting, it was kept there. How wonderful God is for teaching his people in ways that are not only with words, but with symbols. Notice also there were the sin offerings, which had, might be a bull, a goat, or a lamb. The trespass offerings were females. The sin offerings were male. The trespass offerings were female of the flock, the lamb, the goat, the kid, or a bird, or grain. Now, the interesting thing is every meat offering, every flesh offering had with it a grain offering, which is called in Scripture a meat offering. But actually, it's a grain offering. And every offering then had two different things. It had a blood offering and a non-blood offering. Now, once Christ died, he died once for all. And once he died, he would never die again. Therefore, the flesh offerings would no longer exist after Christ came. He would replace that with his own body and with the faith in his blood. And the grain offering would portray the same thing. When Jesus was about ready to leave his people, just before his crucifixion, he gave them a special ceremony, what we call a communion service. And that communion service had bread and wine. The bread is a grain offering. The wine is a symbol of his blood. When you have the grain offering and the wine, it is the same as having, in ancient times, the sacrifice of animals and the grain offering. So always there was a grain offering, but there was also a certain amount of wine or grape juice that went with each sacrifice. Now, we've already talked about the grain offering, but this is symbolizes here. Sometimes the grain offering would be in flour, and sometimes it would be mixed with oil. Different preparations have different symbols, and the grain offering sometimes was baked. And sometimes it was just the flour itself. And by the way, all of these offerings, grain offerings and the wine and so forth, after their symbolic usage, these would be used by the priests and God's plan for sustaining them, because the priests were not to have employment in something else to earn money to, you know, to have sustenance, but the sanctuary itself provided their sustenance. The sacrifices, yes.
Earlier, when we were talking about the sacrifice and the oblation, is this what this means by oblation, this right here?
Yeah, the sacrifice and oblations had to do with the animal sacrifices and the grain offerings and the wine and so forth, yes.
So the oblation is the grain?
Yes. Now, the sacrifice was necessary for forgiveness. Now, the person who developed this program had somewhat different understandings. It's obvious that he thought that those sacrifices did atone for sin. They did not. Not any of them did what they symbolized. They were symbols. They were not the reality itself. No Israelite was atoned by the physical symbols that they were using. But every time they sacrificed a lamb in type and by faith, they were looking to Christ, who was the lamb alone, who alone could save them from sin. So when Christ died on the cross, he died for the sins of all the people before the cross as well as after. And here it says the sacrifice was necessary for forgiveness. Well, the statement is true if we understand what we're talking about. The sacrifice as a symbol of Christ was necessary for forgiveness. Now, God did not forgive them because they sacrificed lambs. He forgave them because they were acting in faith And they were visualizing their faith in the sacrifice to come, which was Christ. It's a very important thing for us to understand that. The Jews were not saved by their sacrifices, any more than we are. We are not saved by the works we do. We are saved by faith in Christ. It's Christ's righteousness alone. In our last session, Daniel's prayer emphasized that over and over again. Not, he says that righteousness belongs to you, O God, and not for our righteousnesses do I ask for your intercession, but for your righteousness. So Christ's righteousness is the only righteousness, and lambs and goats and bullocks simply stood as a symbol of the fact that the wages of sin is death. They could not have life without death. And they would either die themselves or they would choose to believe in Christ's future coming and his future sacrifice. And the sacrifice of the animals was a testimony that they believed in Christ, who they had not yet come. But they believed he would come and that he would take care of their sins, so that it's the same then, we're saved by faith in Christ. A proper sacrifice was an animal that was valuable and was perfect without flaw. Because Christ is the most valuable thing. He was the only Son of God. And he was perfect in every way, though he became man and he took upon himself our sin. He became sin for us. It was not because he was sinful, though he was without sin, became sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. You see the exchange that we have of Christ coming to become our righteousness and share that righteousness with us. Sin was serious. Only the shed blood, which stands for life, could pay for sin. When Adam and Eve sinned, God said, "When you sin, you shall surely die." And they were under the death sentence. They were dead people as far as God may have sustained their life in grace and mercy, but they were under the death sentence. And the reason why there is no life except in Christ is because when we're born into this world, we're born in this world as sinners. And we continue to sin, and we cannot help it. We cannot overcome sin because of our own righteousness. We have none. We can only trust in the righteousness of Christ and by faith claim his blood as the basis for our life. His blood takes the place of our death and gives us life. He that has the Son has life. He that has not the Son of God has not life. This is 1 John 5, verses 10 and so forth. So Christ is our life. He is everything to us. Sin is very serious, required the death of either our death or the death of one who was worthy to die. And we'll find out in Revelation where the question is, who is worthy to open the book which had to do with salvation? No one in heaven or earth could answer that they were worthy. But as John begins to cry, then the messenger came to him and said, "Don't cry, we have found somebody. It's a lion of the tribe of Judah." So he turns to see the lion and he sees a lamb. Christ is the lion of the tribe of Judah, a symbol of strength and power, but he could not be the lion without becoming the lamb. It is the lamb that gives him his strength and his power. It's his blood, his sacrificed blood. By laying on the hand, the priest or the, depending on whether it's the priest in morning and evening service or the sin offering of the person that comes when we're sinned, they lay the hand and confess the sin over the head of the lamb. And this is symbolic of a transfer of our guilt to Christ, who died for us, not for himself. Though he were perfect, he was sinless, but he became sin for us. Now, the bronze altar, then, as I mentioned before, is a symbol of atonement. It's a symbol of the cross. The cross is a symbol of atonement. God connecting heaven with earth again. Adam and Eve separated heaven from earth by rebelling against the Creator. All God asked was they could eat every tree, any place, but there's just one tree he reserved. He said that, and he reserved it for purpose because it's the only place that Satan was allowed to tempt them. If they had stayed away from the tree, they would never have been tempted, but they would be developing character by making a choice. Every day they'd be making, every day they'd come and there were two trees in the midst of the garden, the tree of life, the tree of knowledge. So every day they would choose which the one they wanted to do. And if they chose the tree of life, they would never be tormented by the evil one. But they chose the tree of knowledge of good and evil, which was a choice of the rebellion against God and his law. The problem of sin is the problem of rebellion. Sin separates us from God by our own choice. We choose to go a different direction. We choose something different. But Jesus is the ultimate sacrifice. The blood of the animals made the people of Israel clean and forgiven temporarily. Now, I have to disagree with that. The blood of the animals did not do anything but provide a means for them. There were two trees. They chose one or the other. The animals gave them the choice of whether to believe in a coming seed, Savior, or whether to receive the wages of sin themselves. Christ was going to come. They lifted up on the stake, Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness. A strange thing, at first it seemed so hard for me to understand, how when the serpents were biting the people and they were dying, God commanded Moses to put a serpent on a pole and put it up before them. If they looked at it, they would live. If they didn't look, they would die. Why? Because that serpent was a symbol of Satan, who is a symbol of all sin, and when the people were bitten, it's because they were sinning. They were rebelling against God, and they were murmuring and complaining. And when they looked at that, they saw their substitute for their own sin. Christ would die so they could live. And that is what the serpent on the pole was a symbol of, that Christ would die in our place. The Bible says that Jesus is the ultimate sacrifice, and his death makes believers clean forever before God. Now that is true. That is said before about the animals being necessary is only true symbolically. That is, if we understand those animals to represent Christ, yes, it's Christ. Christ was the only one for Abraham's salvation and Jacob's and Israel and Isaac and Jacob and so forth. He was the only basis for their salvation, but to show their faith in him, they offered a sacrifice. And this is what we show our faith today by receiving him, seeking to be guided by him, and to reflect his character to others, to win them to him. But when we sin, we misrepresent him so that people are taken away. The greatest single cause of atheism is Christians. That's the very greatest single cause. Because Christians who misrepresent God cause people to reject God. And if they have false doctrines, it also takes away. The greatest cause of doctrinal alienation is hellfire. The doctrine that individuals for a very short time will burn forever and ever in excruciating pain and never be relieved ever from all eternity. Now that's not a picture of God, that's a picture of the devil. That's what the devil would do. He'd like to do that. But the fact is, we misrepresent God when we do not understand and proclaim the truth regarding God and His character. We mentioned before that when John the Baptist saw Jesus approaching, he said, "Behold the Lamb of God, which takes away the sins of the world." That's John 1:29. Now, the laver, I mentioned we would speak further about the laver. The laver is a symbol of the water in the laver. That is a symbol of the Holy Spirit. The Bible uses oil as a symbol of the Holy Spirit. It also uses water as a symbol of the Holy Spirit. And water is a cleansing agent. We use water for all kinds of cleansing, whether it's our hands, our face, our whole body, or perhaps our dirty dishes, and whatever it is, our clothes. Water cleanses. It's a symbol of the Holy Spirit who alone can cleanse the heart. And when the priests in their ministry, before they ever could go into the sanctuary, and by the way, please notice, I'll try to get back this, please notice that the whole sanctuary is a path to God. Starts at the court, open the gate, and you go through, and if you were able to see the sanctuary laid out, you'd find that it actually forms a cross. A line would draw from that point to the mercy seat and to the Shekinah glory, which is a symbol of God's presence. And then you find that the holy place, the bread and the candlesticks tend to form a cross, so that everything about the sanctuary, including the way it's drafted and laid out, focuses on the cross. But getting back to the laver, if it were not for the work of the Holy Spirit, the breath of Christ would be meaningless, because you can't change your heart. I can't change my heart. The Holy Spirit can. When we learn of Christ and claim His blood, we need one more agent. In order for this to be of help, we must have the Holy Spirit, who is able to write the law of God in our hearts and in our minds, and to cleanse us from all the uncleanness and the sinfulness. So the priests were just human beings who also had to be cleansed, and they could never enter the holy place without first washing their hands and feet at the altar, so as a symbol of them being clean before they can go before God. Otherwise, they would be stricken down by God's own presence. And God wants to protect us against His presence in the light of sin. He is seeking to make us holy so we can live with a holy God throughout eternity. So this laver, then, is a symbol of how we are cleansed as well as how the priests are cleansed. And individually, by the way, we are priests, according to Scripture. And Peter quotes Exodus 19, which says, "You are a peculiar people, a holy priesthood." God's people are to be His priests to the world, to carry the message to the others, share with them what we have received of the gospel. And everyone who is converted and receives Christ is to be a priest. Every single one is to be a pure priest, ministering to the world, ministering to the family, to the neighborhood, and beyond. In fact, God has given us the requirement to go to all the world with this message. And it's not just pastors. That's just one of the gifts of the Holy Spirit. they're teachers, and there are many other things. But one of the gifts of the Spirit is one of the gifts is the gift of helps, and many people can be helpful, even though they may not have some special outstanding talent. They can be helpful to others who do have various talents. And God has given us all different talents. Brother Henry has become very important to me in the last 4 years because he videos all the messages I give, including this one. If this one is seen on YouTube, then the reason is because Brother Henry has taken his time and given his effort to make this possible, so that he has become as important to this message as I am. If I teach these things, when he first heard me preach, I was preaching to a certain small group of people. And he said, this needs to be sent to all the people around. So he volunteered. I pay him nothing. He gives to me the service that is necessary for my ministry to be completed. And so it is. Throughout his work, God gives different gifts to different people, brings them together, so that together their gifts are complete. Without coming together, without ministering together, and this is why God has a church. It's so we can minister together, so we can reach out, and each one of us can contribute something, but none of us can contribute everything. So that as we work together, God is able to reach out to the whole world. Now, this is, again, this is a pointing to where the bronze laver was. And here again, the arrow pointing to the laver. You'll notice the altar of continual burnt offering, and then between that, just halfway between that and the holy place, is the laver. And it's at that laver that the priests are required to wash every day. Every time they're going to go into the holy place, they wash. And that's our necessity. Every day we need to wash. We need to seek the Holy Spirit every day. We need to be cleansed. As we do, gradually we become more and more apt to reflect the character of God, because the Holy Spirit not only washes us and cleanses us, but he writes in our hearts the law of God, so that his very presence is seen in us. And God intends that we are all temples of the Holy Spirit. And that as we go from place to place, our very presence will be a blessing to others. And if it is not, then it's sad, because it can be. It is supposed to be and will be if we look to Christ in faith. We're looking to Christ, not the Holy Spirit. But the Holy Spirit points our minds to Christ in order that we can respond to Christ, so that he is permitted to do for us what he needs to do, cleansing and writing the law in our minds and hearts. The bronze laver and its bronze stand were made from mirrors of the women who served at the tabernacle of the tent of meeting. So the mirrors that they had, they dedicated to the sanctuary, and those mirrors were used then in developing the bronze altar. The exact size of the laver is not shown, is not described in Scripture. Sometimes, perhaps that's because it's measureless. The Holy Spirit's work, no one knows what the Holy Spirit can do through any given person who surrenders himself fully to the Holy Spirit. There will be constant growth, and there is no way to measure that, so that the work of the Holy Spirit is endless. and he intends for us to be focused constantly on Jesus so he can be focused on us in producing in us what we see in him. And that is the way his righteousness then is transferred to us internally and not just externally. It is not just a matter of claiming forgiveness, it's a matter of being cleansed by his blood. We're cleansed by the blood of Christ, by the ministry of the Holy Spirit. When Jesus was here, he says, I'm going to send you another comforter. He will take my place, and I will be with you forever. How is he to be with us? Through the Holy Spirit. So that labor is a very important item. The labor was located, as I mentioned before, halfway between the altar of continual burning offering and the tabernacle. I think we've already covered this, and here's just a little portrait showing the priest washing his hands from this. The washing of the hands and the feet are a symbol of sanctification, so that every day we must be sanctified. Sanctification is the work of a lifetime. Any day in which we're not being sanctified, that means purified by the Holy Spirit, then we are actually dying, and spiritually dying, so that we can no longer, we're no longer holy. If we are holy, it's because of the Holy Spirit's presence. If we're not holy, it's because of the Holy Spirit's absence. So it's just as clear as that. Serving God requires not just cleansing from sin, but desiring holiness. I mentioned about the law of God written in the heart. That gives us a longing for the law. We love the law. When the person came to Jesus and said, which is the greatest law command? Jesus said, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with your body and mind. Now, the fact is that loving God is the key to Christian experience. But it is that love that we share with our neighbors. And the second is likened to it, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Now, I want you to notice that if we do not love our neighbors ourselves, we don't love God. The greatest test of love for God is how we treat our neighbor, and especially how we treat those who mistreat us. Because God intends for us to love our enemies, and he gives us the power through the Holy Spirit to love our enemies. He gives us his own love by which we share it with our enemies. And this is the work of God. The Bible tells us to cleanse our hearts from guilt before approaching God. Now, the Bible in Hebrews 10:22 mentions the need to purify your hearts, ye sinners, and so forth. But we ought to understand how we can purify our hearts. The rest of the Bible teaches us in many ways that we cannot cleanse them ourselves. But we must cleanse them through the power and presence of the Holy Spirit. It is the Holy Spirit that removes sin and guilt from us, so that we do not cleanse our own personal hearts before we can be approaching God, because we have to approach him in order to overcome sin. And to cleanse ourselves from sin is the work of the Holy Spirit, not a work of ourselves. We choose to obey. The Holy Spirit gives us power to obey. Paul says, it is God that works in you both to will, to desire, and to do of his good pleasure. The followers of Jesus have accepted his sacrificial death on their behalf, and that is how they can live a holy life. And that is the only way in which they can live a holy life. Well, it's time for us to close our discussion. And I think it's a wonderful plan that the sanctuary portrays, isn't it? Where the righteousness that we need is in him. It is the sanctuary in various ways that portrays how we receive his righteousness. And whether we're talking about justification through the cross or sanctification through the Holy Spirit, those two must go together. And if we're not justified by God's grace, by claiming his blood, we cannot be sanctified. And if we are justified, sanctification has already begun, because that puts us in connection with God, and only through the Holy Spirit are we actually led to justification. So let us pray for, bow our heads for prayer. Father, thank you so much for your many blessings. You know our hearts. You know our need. You know that Jesus is the only answer, that his death is the only means of dealing with guilt and with sin, and that the Holy Spirit, symbolized by the laver, is there every day for us, the continual, to continue to write the law in our minds and in our hearts, so we love the law, and so we seek to win others to you. We pray for your presence in our lives, and that you'll help us to be true ministers to others. In the name of Jesus, amen. Let us